Hi and welcome to PMPLounge.com. Today we are going over the tools and techniques of the define scope process. We have made a video earlier on what define scope process is. I'll link to that in the description so you can definitely go over and understand what define scope process is, where it falls, and where we are basically when it comes to the PMBOK syllabus, right? So today we are discussing the tools and techniques. There are three tools and techniques used for define scope process. One is facilitated workshops, product analysis, and alternatives generation. So let's get started. Let's try to understand what these three are. So facilitated workshops, as the name goes, right, you need to go over the requirements that you have already collected in the previous process, which was the collect requirements process, and you need to go over all the requirements that you have collected with the stakeholders at the same time in the form of a workshop. So you basically seek time from all these stakeholders, you invite all of them, you conduct a workshop, and you go over all the requirements that you have collected in the collect requirements process. Now this is going to help and narrow down on the project scope, because while collecting requirements, and there are so many tools and techniques of collect requirements, we have covered all of them. I'll leave a link to the entire playlist of that below. You can go over that. So there are so many tools and techniques for collecting requirements, and once you have all those requirements, you need to narrow them down and come up with a project scope. How do you do that? You do that with the tools and techniques of the defined scope process, and one of them is facilitated workshops, where you invite all these stakeholders and try to come down on the project scope, right? Narrow down on the project scope. So there's one important goal, right, or one important part of this technique, that is to ensure that requirements have quantifiable goals. So while you're collecting requirements, right, you can have certain requirements that cannot be quantified, that cannot be measured. But with facilitated workshops, in the presence of all these stakeholders, you need to make sure that all those requirements have quantifiable goals. They can be measured. And here's an example, right? So Jack says, we need to make sure with this project, our product gets easier to use. Now, easier to use, that is not something which can be measured. That's not quantifiable. But what Jill says is measurable. That's quantifiable. Jill says, our goal is to reduce customer support requests by 15%. So when you're doing your project, you need to make sure, you need to define your scope in a manner that the product is easier to use to the customers. You can target when do customers come back and ask for support on what kind of topics related to the product of the project. And then on those areas, right, on those topics, you can work on and make sure that those areas are made easier so that support requests are reduced by 15%. So that is a quantifiable goal. That is something facilitated workshops can definitely help you come up with. Moving on to product analysis. So while you're collecting requirements, right, in your collect requirements process, while you're collecting all the requirements, you will come across a strange thing, and that is that every stakeholder, they tend to and they are inclined to talk about the requirements from the perspective of the product and not the perspective of the project, right? So everybody will talk about how the product should be. They'll not talk about what you should be doing in your project to make sure that the product, changes, or the product, incorporates the change, incorporates the requirement that they are talking about. So let's take an example here, right? So here's an example of the requirement that says the website is graphics intensive and loads slowly. We need a less graphics intensive website that should load quicker. So the requirement here is that the website contains a lot of graphics. We need lighter graphics to make sure that the website loads quickly, because right now the website is very slow. Now, if you see, we are just talking from the perspective of the product. The product of the project in this case is, of course, the website, right? So we are talking in terms of what we need from the product. We need the product to be less graphics intensive. We need the product to load quicker. But what do you need to do to make sure that this is resulted in the product, right? This results, this change, this requirement is applicable to the product. What do you need to do in your project? And that is where product analysis comes in the picture, right? So with this technique, you need to convert these product-oriented requirements into actual project work. So with continuing the example that we just talked about, it'll help you understand this in a much better fashion. And that is the graphics team needs to come up with lighter graphics for the website. Now, do you see the difference between both the examples? In example one, we talked about the product of the project. We just talked about the website. We just said that the website should load quicker, the website should have graphics which are, lighter, right? But when we are doing this product analysis, when we are applying this technique of the defined scope process, we define the scope of the project and we come up with the scope statement that says the graphics team needs to come up with lighter graphics, right? So this is a project-oriented requirement, right? Let me highlight that for you. So this is the project-oriented requirement, while the one above is definitely a product-oriented requirement. This, they don't talk about what you need to do in your project to make sure this is achieved, right? This, they don't talk about what you need to do in your product, in your project to achieve this, but this talks about what you need to do in your project to achieve this result in the product. So that is why product analysis is an important technique, and that is the use of the product analysis technique. Now, let's move ahead. Alternatives generation is the third tools and technique for the defined scope process, and what it talks about basically is coming up with other ways of accomplishing a job. There could be a job and you need to come up with the alternate ways, right? Because the alternate ways, with by thinking about the alternate ways, you can come up in most cases with a better approach of doing things, right? So that is why you use this technique to make sure you are doing accomplishing the scope of the project in the best way possible, right? So this is a technique of defined scope because it may lead to a change in the scope or other project constraints, right? So when you're making use of this technique, right, your scope may change, you or any other constraint of the project, right, like your time, your cost, they may also change. So that is why you are going over this process in the defined scope process itself. You are making use of this technique in the defined scope process itself. It'll be much clearer when we look at an example here, right? So, can the existing IT infrastructure with another department, which is available with another department, be used for 2 weeks to meet the testing requirements of the project? Now, this is interesting, right? So a lot of times when you want to test your project, you might need a certain environment. You might need certain IT infrastructure to create that environment, right? Let's say you are let's say your product of the project is an app for the Apple ecosystem, right? You need that app to run on macOS and you need that app to run on iOS. So in order to test that, you need an environment of macOS and you need an environment of iOS, right? So this kind of infrastructure, either your project should kind of provide the cost for coming up with these environments, or if there's another department, if there's another project that already has created certain apps for macOS and iOS, they will be having this requirement, this environment with them already because they would have tested their apps too. So, alternatives generation, right? When you're using this technique, you will come up with ideas wherein you can kind of say that you can kind of suggest that you can use an existing environment within the company itself, existing IT infrastructure within the company itself, rather than accommodating And adding the cost of coming up with this IT infrastructure, arranging this IT infrastructure for your project, right? So what will this lead to? This can lead to realignment of your project dates, because you need to make sure the other team provides you that environment. What dates can they support? And you might have to realign your project based on the dates that you will get the IT infrastructure from the different department, right? And the other thing is, it can also help you reduce the project cost, like I was talking about. You don't have to buy your own Mac OS and iOS environment if you already have that within your organization, right? So in the original project scope, you might have considered the cost of the iOS and Mac OS environments, the IT infrastructure required to provide these environments. But when you come up and when you do this alternatives generation technique, when you follow this technique, you might come up with an idea where you can use the existing environment which is available with other department, and that is going to help you reduce the cost of your project. So those were the three tools and techniques of the Define Scope process. Hope you were able to follow and learn this. Subscribe to this YouTube channel if you haven't done so already. Check us out on our social media, facebook.com/pmplounge and twitter.com/pmplounge. You can always send your queries related to project management to pmplounge@gmail.com. And don't forget, there will be an attached article, corresponding article to this topic available on pmplounge.com, which is your number one free resource for PMP certification and project management industry information. Thank you.